and welcome. Time Computer Systems is the UK's leading PC supplier to home users and small businesses. Established for 10 years, Time Computers provides a quality range of PC solutions with reliable service and support to several hundred thousand customers. They've recently expanded their activities, opening some 26 showrooms located throughout the UK. The showrooms represent a unique concept in retail buying, enabling you to try out the systems but still take advantage of the cost benefits of buying mail order. The showrooms are staffed by highly trained, knowledgeable sales teams who can provide free advice on the systems that meet your specific requirements. Each showroom has its own service centre where technical staff are available to help with technical problems and at the same time provide a range of upgrade services. The majority of Time Computers customers use mail order, and to provide the very best quality products, service and support, they have developed and continue to maintain a wide range of service facilities at the headquarters. They've invested heavily in personnel and operations to ensure that customers receive the best possible service from every department within the company. Pre-sales service is available from fully trained sales staff who are happy to give free advice on the most suitable solution for your needs. The aim is to achieve complete customer satisfaction, and a member of the customer service department will always be on hand to ensure that any queries are resolved as quickly as possible. Also, a dedicated team of technical support staff will provide hotline support should your system ever malfunction or require an upgrade. In addition, there's a fully equipped in-house facility to repair the majority of products they sell, and they also offer a comprehensive upgrade service. Time Computers continues to invest heavily in all of these customer and support services. At present, they employ over 600 members of staff at their headquarters and showrooms. All of them are dedicated to providing the highest quality solutions and service at the most competitive price. You can normally place your order direct with a sales team, or alternatively by calling into one of the showrooms. Your order will be processed and your details entered onto the computer system. Details of your payment method and delivery address are also taken. If you're ordering a system on finance, a deposit may be taken and you'll be sent credit agreement forms to sign. Please return these as soon as possible, as your order can't be processed without them. You'll be quoted an approximate delivery time. Normally, this is 10 to 14 days after payment is cleared. Please don't chase delivery of your PC prior to 14 working days. Once your order is taken and payment cleared, your system is picked and configured to your specification. Software is preloaded and the system is burnt in for many hours or even days. Final quality checking ensures that everything is in order. Your system will be sent to you by courier. If you're not in, the courier will leave a card so that you can contact them directly to arrange an alternative date and time. When the system arrives, check the number of boxes and that they have no external damage. If you do have any problems with the delivery of your PC, contact the customer services department. How to do that is covered later in the video. Your PC will be in boxes of various shapes and sizes. Typically, there'll be three boxes, one for the PC itself, one for the monitor, and one for any additional accessories, such as speakers, joystick, or software CDs. If you've bought a printer, this will be in a separate box. Before unpacking, take the boxes into the room where you want your PC to be. This will save you having to carry the PC around later. When you unpack your PC and monitor, it's important that you flat pack the boxes and keep them safe. These can then be used later should you need to move your PC or return it to us for an upgrade or repair.
Once you've unpacked your PC, check that you've received all the bits and pieces you need. These will vary depending on the type of PC solution you've purchased. In general, you should have your system unit, a keyboard, power cable, a mouse, and a binder containing the documentation and some of the software relevant to your system. Typically, this will include the user guide, Windows 95 manual and CD, the computer motherboard manual, pre-installed software guide, a system CD containing all the drivers and associated software for your PC, and a coloured recovery disk.
Next, unpack your monitor. You should have the monitor, the stand, a power cable, and a user manual. Any additional hardware and software, such as speakers, joystick, and software CDs, will be in your accessories box. The invoice will also be sent with your PC, and that's normally packed into the accessories box. However, if you don't have an accessories box, then the invoice will be in your PC box. If any items are missing, don't panic. Check all the boxes. Look at the invoice. Some items might be marked to follow, which means that they weren't in stock when your PC was shipped, and they will follow shortly. Finally, if the missing items aren't marked to follow, contact customer services. We'll show you how to do this later in the video.
Before connecting your PC together, however, it's essential that you read the user guide, pre-installed software booklet, and Windows 95 manual. All these manuals are designed to help you get off to a smooth start with your new PC and avoid doing anything that may damage your new computer. Your sound card, CD, modem, and printer won't work if they're not set up correctly, so please read the manuals. Once you've read the manuals, you're ready to connect everything together and to start using your PC. Don't worry. It's not as bad as it looks. The first thing you need to decide is where to put your new PC, and choosing the right location is important. Here are a few do's and don'ts when choosing a location. Do: choose a hard flat surface, such as a desk, with plenty of room for all the system and cables. Ensure that the area you've chosen is well ventilated, and operate your PC at normal room temperature, which is between 10 and 35 degrees C. If you have a modem, ensure that your PC is near a telephone point. Don't place your PC in direct sunlight. Don't place it near a radiator or any magnetic sources. And don't operate your PC in extreme moisture or humidity. Don't place it in a room subject to excessive noise or vibration. Right, now that you've chosen a location, it's time to connect your PC together. And there are two main types of computer design: desktop and mini tower. If you have a desktop PC, it's convenient to stand the monitor on top of a desktop case. It saves space, and the monitor's usually at eye level. Oh, incidentally, don't forget to attach a stand to your monitor. If you have a mini tower, then stand the PC next to the monitor on whichever side you won't be using the mouse. Now, whatever type of PC you've purchased, the connections at the back will be the same and have the same functions. Right, let's connect your system together. Refer to the big Getting Started leaflet that's provided with your system. Okay, first connect your keyboard. Next, connect your mouse to the mouse port. Next, connect your monitor. Connect your speakers to the line-out socket on the connector panel, not to be confused with the SPK socket on the modem. And if you have a joystick, connect it to your games port. Next, connect your power cable from the back of the monitor to the wall socket and switch it on. Next, connect your power cable from your PC to the wall socket. And finally, switch on the mains power switch located at the rear of the PC, near the mains lead socket. Ensure that when you connect your PC together, all the connections are firm. Also, never connect anything to your PC whilst it's switched on, as this may damage components within your PC. The Universal Serial Bus is a new type of technology, which makes it even easier to connect peripherals such as monitors, printers, scanners, speakers, modems, joysticks, and other multimedia games equipment. The USB will become the standard for computer equipment connection, and almost all new peripherals will be fitted with USB connectors. Before you switch on, you need to familiarize yourself with the switches and LED lights on the front of your PC. Depending on what type of PC you've purchased, the switches and LED lights will be in different positions, but they all have the same functions. The first thing you'll notice is the standby resume switch. This is different to a conventional on-off switch, as it allows your PC to remain in a very low power state until you want to use it. The standby is the recommended mode to leave your PC in when it's not being used. Now, you'll also have a reset switch, which is used to reboot, i.e. restart your PC, without you having to switch the PC off and then back on again. There's a green LED light, which indicates that your PC is switched on, which is marked with a symbol of a light bulb. And there's also a red LED light, which flashes to indicate hard disk activity, which is marked with the symbol of a drum. In order to use your PC, you'll need to communicate with it by giving it instructions and manipulating it to carry out operations. Now, this is done using the keyboard and mouse. You'll also need to load programs and software onto your PC, and for this purpose, you'll use the floppy drive and the CD-ROM drive. Let's look at each of these more closely. But just before we do, now would be a good time to mention the difference between hardware and software. Hardware is what we've been putting together. It's what you can see and touch. The PC itself, the monitor, printer, keyboard, and mouse. But by itself, the hardware can do absolutely nothing. It needs a set of instructions, a program to tell it what to do. And that's all software is, a set of instructions. Software is stored on disks, floppy disks, hard disks, and CDs too. But it's important not to confuse the disk with the software itself. The disk is just a storage area for the instructions. When you run a piece of software, it's copied from the disk into the computer's memory, and the instructions are carried out from there. There are thousands and thousands of pieces of software available for the PC. The keyboard is an essential part of the PC. It looks like a typewriter keyboard, but it has a lot more keys. You can see the familiar typewriter keyboard layout in the middle. This is the return or the enter key, and when you type in a command, you press the return key to send it into the computer. There are two shift keys, a tab key, and a caps lock key, which work like the keys on a typewriter. The F keys across the top are function keys, which software programs use as a quick way of accessing special functions, such as printing a document or saving a file. And the function of these keys will be different depending on the software program that you're using. The alternate and control keys are used in conjunction with other keys to perform different functions. For example, control and C may be used to copy a block of text. Alt and F may be used to bring up a file menu. The latest keyboards have special Windows 95 keys which have specific functions for use with Windows 95. For a more comprehensive guide to your keyboard, refer to Chapter 2 in your user guide. Now, let's take a look at the mouse. This little fellow's largely responsible for popularizing PCs by making them easy to use. Instead of typing commands into the computer, you can use the mouse to point to items on the screen. Movements of the mouse correspond with movements of the mouse pointer on the screen. Most mice have two buttons. A few have three, but you only need two for the vast majority of programs. The left button is used for most operations, and the right button for special functions, for example, to call up a special menu. There are one or two basic movements you have to master, but it's not difficult. If you move the mouse around on a flat surface, you'll see the pointer on the screen move, and if you point to an item and click the left mouse, the item is selected. If you double-click, the item is activated. And if you place the pointer on an item and hold down the left button and move the mouse, you can drag the item across the screen, and by letting go of the left button, you can drop the item. Now, this can be used, for example, when moving or copying files between folders. Windows 95 provides a mouse tutorial which will help you master basic mouse functions when you first switch on your PC. For a more comprehensive guide to using the mouse, refer to Chapter 2 of your user guide. This is a floppy disk drive, and this is a floppy disk. Now, these are also used to store programs and data like the hard disk, but they have a much smaller capacity. Floppy disks can be used to store your data and to load software onto your hard disk. And there are two main sizes of floppy in common use, double density and high density. A high density disk has a capacity of 1.44 megabytes. A double density disk can store around half of that. You can tell if a disk is high density by the square hole at the top left. If the computer can see through this part of the disk, it knows there's a high density disk in the drive. There's another hole on the other side, on both types of disk, and a slider, and this is the Write Protect tab. If you slide it so you can see through the hole, the computer cannot write data to the disk. Before you install a piece of software, make sure the Write Protect tab is open to protect the data on the disk. When inserting a floppy disk into your drive, always make sure that the labeled side is furthest away from the eject button. It's important that you look after your floppy disks. After using them, put them away safely in a disk box. And also keep your floppy disks away from magnetic sources such as speakers. If you've purchased a CD-ROM drive, it'll look similar to this. They usually have a tray which slides out where you put the CD. There are many types of CD-ROM drive available, ranging from 8-speed to 24-speed. CD-ROM drives all have similar features on the front panel. You'll certainly have an eject button, and you may also have a play and stop button, which allows you to play audio CDs from the front of the drive. There's also a busy LED light, which flashes when the drive is reading a CD. Some CD-ROM drives will also have an audio connection for plugging in headphones or speakers, as well as a volume control. When you insert the CD into the drive, make sure that the printed side is on top, because it's the underside of the CD which the drive reads. Now, the major difference between CDs and hard disks is that you can't write to a CD. You can't save programs and data to it. CDs, therefore, are mainly a read-only medium. Although writable CD-ROMs are now available on the market, and it won't be long before they're a common feature of PCs. A CD can store up to 650 megabytes of data, which enables software developers to create gigantic programs containing massive amounts of text and graphical information. Encyclopedias on CD, for example, include images as well as text, and sounds, and moving pictures too. After you press the standby button to activate your computer for the first time, the first thing you'll see are lots of messages on the screen as the PC performs its various self-tests and startup procedures. Windows 95 will then run automatically, but first you'll have to enter some details about yourself and how you want Windows 95 to start up each time you use it. Windows then stores this information, so you only need to enter it once. Moving on to the next screen, you're asked for some user information. In other words, your name or your company's, if applicable. Now, once you've entered these details, click on the next button. The next screen is the license for Windows 95. Now, this is a legal agreement explaining the terms and conditions under which you're allowed to use Windows 95. The agreement is reproduced on the inside front cover of your Introducing Microsoft Windows 95 manual for future reference. Click on I accept the agreement when you've read and understood the Microsoft agreement, and then click on Next. Unfortunately, if you wish to proceed, there's no alternative. The next screen is the Certificate of Authenticity. In the box provided, enter the number displayed on the front cover of your certificate after the word Product ID. And there's a picture here on the screen to show you. Now, Windows 95 displays the Start Wizard screen to inform you that it's saved the information you've just provided. Move the mouse pointer to the Finish button and click once with the left mouse button. At this stage, Windows 95 informs you that you'll have to restart the PC in order to process the information you've provided. Click on the OK button and your PC will restart automatically. Now, once the PC restarts, it displays a screen entitled the Backup Recovery Diskette. Now, what's a recovery diskette, I hear you ask? Well, the recovery diskette is the brightly coloured disk that you received in the binder in your system box. Read the instructions on the screen and insert the colored disk into the floppy disk drive and type Y. Now, the process may take a few minutes and you need to be patient. Firstly, the disk is formatted and then important files are copied onto the disk. Now, once the copy process has ended, remove the disk from the floppy drive and label the disk with this label. And the diskette is now called the Original Recovery Diskette. The recovery diskette is to be used only when your computer system has problems booting up or if you have problems because of alterations in systems files. And these could affect use of the sound card, the CD-ROM, or modems, etc. The use of the recovery diskette is explained in more detail later on in the video. Now, once you've finished making your recovery diskette, press any key and your PC will be restarted automatically. After your PC has restarted, you're presented with the Microsoft Windows 95 startup menu. And this will appear every time you boot up your PC from now on. The Microsoft Windows startup menu allows you to start your PC in different ways. Now, most of the time, you'll select option 1, which is the normal Windows 95 startup, and it'll take you straight into the Windows 95 desktop. Alternatively, option 2 is designed to free up extra memory in order to allow you to run memory-hungry games in DOS. In other words, games that need to load a vast amount of instruction into your PC's memory in order to work. Now, if you don't select an option within 15 seconds, then option 1 is automatically chosen for you. And you can see Chapter 7 of your user guide for a more detailed explanation of the Microsoft Windows 95 startup menu. Compass is a new way of helping you get the most out of your PC immediately by providing a reliable and user-friendly way of running the preloaded software and using the most common features of Windows 95. New computer users in particular will find Compass the best way to become familiar with their PC before jumping into full use of the Windows 95 environment. It's supplied with some of our computer systems, so when you've completed the initial setup procedure and made the recovery diskette, if Compass is provided with your system, the Compass Setup program will appear. You'll be asked to enter a password. Type in a password that you want to use, and then once entered, you'll need to retype it in the Confirm Password box. You also need to select if you would like to enable the security feature, which will allow you to restrict other users in their use of Compass. For example, you might not want your children to have access to the office, which contains your business files. And finally, you should decide if you want Compass to run each time your machine boots up. Now, if you're already familiar with Windows 95, you may decide that this is not necessary. Now click on the OK button, and you'll be taken to the Compass title screen. Click on the left-hand window, which will take you to the main menu of Compass. And from here, you can navigate the various rooms within Compass. These include the office, kids room, configuration room, and online help. Let's take a look at some of the features within these rooms. In the office, you can launch most of the business-related applications installed on your machine. Simply click the software rack. Then select the piece of software that you wish to load. And it's as simple as that. If you'd wanted to send a fax, you would click on the fax machine. And this will take you to Windows Messaging, from where you can prepare and send a fax. Take a look in the kids' room. Your PC comes with plenty of entertainment programs pre-installed. By clicking on the paper and pencils, you'll be taken into the Microsoft Paint program. You can, of course, prevent users from accessing the games by using the security feature, and here's how. From the main room, click on the configuration room, and then click on the oil painting, which takes you to the security screen. Click on Administer Users, and you'll be able to add and remove users from the system. Using the Next and Previous buttons, browse through the users and select the rooms that you wish that user to have access to. Now, once you've made the changes, click on Update User, and then switch to the Security tab, and select Enable Security. This will make your settings effective. Now let's move on to the Online Help room. Compass is provided with a range of animated tutorials for common Windows tasks. Go into Windows Help and select Screen Cam Animation Help. Select the tutorial that you wish to view and watch the on-screen animation of the selected function. Remember that the function is not actually taking place, it's merely a recording. And Compass has many more features which you can experiment with or read about in the online help or documentation. Once you've finished personalizing your copy of Windows 95 and you've made your valuable recovery diskette, your new PC is ready for use. Whilst you're using your PC, it's possible that you may accidentally damage your preloaded software, and therefore it's recommended that you take backup copies of your preloaded software packages. Now, if you've purchased a backup CD, this step may not be necessary. If you've not purchased a backup CD, then you need to create the individual disks. Diskmaster Pro will allow you to create the install disks for all your preloaded software applications. To use it, click on Start, then move to Programs. A menu will appear. Move on to the menu, and click on Diskmaster Pro from the list. Now, after a few seconds, the Diskmaster Pro program will load, and you'll see a book. Click on the cover of the book to open it, and read through the General Information and Using Diskmaster Pro. To move onto the next page of the book, click on the bottom right-hand corner of the page, and to move back, click on the bottom left-hand corner of the page. To create a disk, click on a disk icon and follow the simple instructions. Now, once you've created all the disks on one page, a new icon will appear in the bottom left-hand corner of the page, and this will allow you to delete the image files that are no longer needed and free up valuable space. Generally, during the use of your PC, we recommend that at regular intervals you back up your data and work, such as important documents or worksheets, by copying these onto floppy disks. First of all, panic! No, don't panic. The chances are the cause is something simple. Many problems with a PC can often be solved quickly and easily, just by knowing the correct thing to do. If your PC won't turn on, make sure all the plugs are snug in their sockets. It's quite easy for the power cable to work loose from the back of the PC or monitor. Check that the main socket you're using is switched on and working, and make sure that both the system unit and the monitor are turned on, as each normally has its own switch. And don't forget to check that the main switch on the rear of the computer is also switched on. Now, you'll know if power is reaching your PC because the power light will light when you switch it on. And the monitor also has a power on light. If either of these lights don't show, then check the fuse in the plug and check the mains lead with another one. If the PC does turn on but there's no display on your monitor, wait a minute or so. Monitors sometimes need to warm up. And if nothing happens, then check the brightness controls on your monitor. They may be turned down. And finally, check that the monitor cable is plugged into your PC properly. And if it is, then remove it and check the pins on the connector to ensure that they've not been accidentally bent. A monitor cable normally has 3 pins missing, and this is nothing to worry about. Now, if the PC just beeps when you turn it on, this is because when you turn your PC on, it carries out a self-check known as a POST, a power-on self-test. And if the POST finds an error, it communicates this as a message on the screen or as audible beeps. Things to check for are that your keyboard is connected and that there's nothing resting on it. Also check to make sure that your monitor cable is connected to the back of the PC. If your PC continues to beep, then it's likely to be an internal fault, and these are covered later in the video. If you get an error message when you turn your PC on, this means that the POST, the power on self-test, has found something wrong with your system, and you need to refer to Chapter 11 of the User Guide for a definition of the possible errors and what action you can take. If you can't see all of the Windows 95 screen on your monitor, use the on-screen controls to adjust the picture so that it covers the whole of the screen. Your monitor user guide will show you how to make these adjustments. We'll cover other problems that may prevent your PC from working later on in the video, together with how to get technical help. And Chapter 11 in your user guide also covers this.
It's important that you do read the troubleshooting section of the manual and use the recovery disk if necessary before you contact these people in technical support for help. The manual also lists support numbers for manufacturers of peripherals and printers, some of whom provide support on their own products. There are 2 support services available, hardware support and software assistance service.
For the first 30-day getting started period, call 01282 77 1199. This is the 30-day support desk for all hardware, software and customer service inquiries, and can be used for any issues relating to the delivery or setup of your PC, and for problems in use over the first 30 days. For post-30-day support, call the Customer Care Centre. There are 2 numbers. For hardware support, call 01282 77 0033. For non-technical support, call 01282 77 7744. The Software Assistance Service number is 0891 515 989. This is a chargeable service for software help.
If your problem relates to hardware malfunction, then contact hardware support on the number shown towards the back of your user guide. Please don't contact hardware support for minor inquiries, which can be resolved by simply reading the manual. It's likely that your call will be answered by an automatic operator who will direct your call to the service or staff you require. If the service or person you need is busy, then the automatic operator will put your call into a queuing system. If your call is too far down the queue, then just call back later. Remember, when you call, always take down the first name of the agent you spoke to. Please don't fax or write in with a list of problems. In order to identify the problem correctly, the support staff need to ask you simple questions. The highest priority is given to incoming support calls, and support staff won't be able to reply to written questions or faxes, as this is unlikely to be successful in resolving your problem. Over 90% of the calls coming into hardware support are related to the software setup. Typically, the software setup gets altered accidentally or during installation of other programs, resulting in malfunction of sound, CD, modem, or other software. Most of these problems can be resolved by the correct use of the recovery disk. Hardware support will be able to resolve the vast majority of problems on the first call. However, you may be asked to try a procedure and ring again. If your problem is related to a fault which requires the return of your unit to the service centre, you'll be issued with an RMA number and asked to prepare the base unit or the entire system for collection. We'll cover this process later. Please note that there is no free software training or software support provided with your PC. Rather than increasing the price of the PC for everyone, this service is there for those people who wish to use it on a pay-as-you-use basis. The software assistance service is a premium rate service. When you call, if the staff are busy, there is a queuing system which allows you to hang on until a support person becomes available. While you're hanging on, you'll hear a ringing tone, which means you are queuing prior to connection and you're not paying any telephone charges while you're waiting. During busy periods, you may have to wait several minutes. If you can't get through, please try again later. Remember, when you call, always take down the first name of the agent you spoke to. You may wish to contact the software assistance service for help on the preloaded software, or installing drivers, resolving compatibility issues, configuring the software for printers, modems, or multimedia. There are three types of repair service available: DOA, which is product reported faulty within the first 14 days, warranty repair, and extended warranty repair. If you think that there is a hardware fault, the procedure with all these is to contact hardware support first. The support staff will try to resolve the problems over the phone. If this isn't possible, they'll ask you to prepare the goods for return to the service centre and issue you with an RMA number, which is the returns authorisation number. Please use the original packaging, which you should have kept safe. Use the computer system return form indicating the nature of your problem and write the RMA number on the stickers which were provided with your system. Stick these onto the box or boxes, don't write directly onto the boxes. If faults are reported within the first 14 days, or if you've purchased extended warranty, then support staff will arrange the collection at no cost to you. If your system develops a fault after 14 days, but within the 1 year standard warranty period, your system will still be repaired free of charge, but you will be responsible for getting the system to the repair centre. In these cases, the hardware support staff can also arrange to collect the system, but there will be a carriage charge. Normally, the system will be collected by the courier and returned to the service centre. The service centre staff will log the system, check its contents and specification, and pass the system to a dedicated engineer who will try to resolve the problems. It's an unfortunate statistic that the majority of product returned for repair is found not to have a hardware fault, but a software setup error which results in malfunctioning of the hardware. If a component is faulty, it's normally replaced. Service staff aim to turn around systems within 7 days, but it can take longer during busy periods. Lead times will be given to you when you are issued with an RMA number. Priority is given to systems which are within the 14-day DOA period or those with extended warranty. Customer services will deal with your general inquiries such as missing items from the delivery, wrong or delayed dispatch, delays in processing your service repair, refunds, and any other issue which is not sales or technical. There is an upgrade service where your PC base unit will be collected, upgraded and returned. Details are available from the upgrade sales number, which is shown at the back of your user guide.
When you start Windows, the large area you see is called the desktop. And you can customize the desktop by adding shortcuts to your favorite programs, documents, and printers, and by changing its look to fit your own preferences and personality. To adjust settings, such as desktop color and background, use your right mouse button to click anywhere on the desktop, and then click Properties. From the display properties, you can change things like background, texture, color, screensavers, display resolutions, and so on. At the bottom of your screen is the taskbar. It contains the Start button. And when you click on it, it brings up the Start menu, which can be used to quickly start a program, open a document, or to find a file, or to shut down your computer. The Start menu is also the fastest way to get Windows Online Help. When you open a program, document, or a window, a button appears on the taskbar, and you can use this button to quickly switch between the different windows you've opened. Your documents and programs are stored in folders, which you can see in My Computer and Windows Explorer. In previous versions of Windows, folders were known as directories, and you can create your own folders in order to organize your work and store important files and documents. You can use My Computer to quickly and easily see everything on your computer. Double-click the My Computer icon on the desktop to look at your PC's disk drives and browse through the files and folders. In Windows Explorer, you can see both the hierarchy of folders on your computer and all the files and folders in each selected folder. Now, this is especially useful for copying and moving files. And you can copy the folder that contains the file you want to move or copy, and then drag it to another folder that you want to put it in. Now, to find Windows Explorer, click the Start button and then point to Programs. If you're using a network, the Network Neighborhood icon appears on your desktop. Double-click it to browse through the computers in your workgroup and the computers on your entire network. There's an icon which looks like a first aid bag called Make Recovery Diskette, and an associated help file for the program. Now, this program will create you a new recovery diskette. Why would you want to do this? Well, if you were to use your original recovery diskette, your Windows 95 PC will lose any of your personal settings because the disk was made straight after post-install setup and before you could change any of the Windows 95 settings to suit your needs. So if you install new software and change your PC settings, make a new recovery diskette. Shortcuts, as the name suggests, provide a shortcut to accessing programs and data. Now, to create a shortcut on the desktop, simply use Windows Explorer to drag the desired program from the Explorer windows onto the desktop. And this will create an icon entitled Shortcut 2 and then the program name. Every window has an X, a close button, in the upper right corner that you can click to close the window and quit the program. The Minimize and Maximize buttons are used to allow a window to be reduced to a button on the taskbar or enlarged to take up the whole of the screen. To start a program, first click the Start button and then point to Programs. Two, if the program you want is not on the menu, point to the folder that contains the program. Three, click the program. After you start a program, a button appears on the taskbar. To switch from one running program to another, click its taskbar button. If the program you want to start doesn't appear on the Programs menu or one of its submenus, point to Find on the Start menu and then click Files or Folders. Use the Find dialog box to locate the program file. New software is supplied on floppy disks or on CD, and many of the CDs supplied by hardware manufacturers will have an autoplay feature. Now, this means that when you place your CD into the CD-ROM drive while in Windows 95, the CD will automatically start to run. Otherwise, there are three different ways in which to start and install or set up program. Now, the first is to click on Start and then click on Run. When the box appears, enter in the location, which is known as the path, of the program you wish to run. For example, A:\setup. The second way is to double-click on My Computer. Double-click on either the floppy drive or the CD drive to see the files present, and then double-click on any file called Install or Setup. The third is, well, you could say the Windows 95 way. Insert either the first floppy disk or CD-ROM disk in the drive and click on Start, then click on Settings, then Control Panel. In a few seconds, the Control Panel will open. Then double-click on Add Remove Programs, then click on Install, and Windows 95 will look for an install program on the floppy drive and the CD drive. When it finds an install program, it'll show you, and you can choose to install the program or exit. Microsoft have made Windows 95 compatible with DOS applications, but how do you get past the Windows graphical user interface and into an environment that looks and feels like DOS? Well, it's easy. Windows 95 made DOS look like an application. You can access a DOS session by clicking on Start, Programs, and then click on MS-DOS Prompt. That's it. You're in DOS. Well, it feels like DOS, and it looks like DOS, but it's actually what the techies call a virtual DOS machine, a VDM for short. So it's not real DOS, but it's very compatible. If you require a full-screen DOS session, press the Alt and Enter, and this will work in reverse. From here, you can run most of the DOS applications. If an application requires more memory to run, shut down and restart the computer in MS-DOS mode. To close the DOS session, either type Exit at the prompt and press Enter, or click on the X in the top right-hand corner of the DOS box. If you're in MS-DOS mode, you can type Exit and return back to Windows. For programs such as DOS games, it's safest to run them in MS-DOS mode. The only advice I'm going to offer you about games is how to play them in MS-DOS mode. If a game crashes or locks out, you don't want it to affect your Windows 95 system. A lot of DOS games require a different configuration of memory to run than Windows 95. The game's documentation will tell you how to create a boot disk with a special configuration of memory. Unfortunately, the memory configuration depends on the game. And whatever you do, do not edit the boot files on your hard disk. Always make a boot disk. These three types of files are in effect the same. They've just been given different names. I'm going to refer to them as system files. System files are very important. When Windows 95 is being loaded, you usually see a nice Windows 95 logo with a flashing bar across the bottom. From time to time, you'll switch into the background and see lots of text and instructions automatically being executed. Now, these are your system files at work. Without these files, your PC is dead in the sense that you can't use it. It will not work without your system files. System files include autoexecbat, configsys, winini, systemini, and a very important Windows registry. Quite often when your sound card or CD-ROM or modem stop working, it's because these files have been altered. Now, in today's energy-conscious world, power conservation and optimization is becoming an integral part of PC systems. Your computer incorporates the latest green hardware and software features for this important area. Your PC and some of its components have the ability to enter a low power mode, known as suspend mode, when they're not being used. Now, in this mode, power usage is negligible, but your PC is ready to wake up when prompted by any movement of the mouse, a key press, or an incoming phone or fax call. This means that your computer need not be left fully powered up when it's unattended. Suspend mode can be entered automatically after a set number of minutes of computer inactivity, or via the start button. The second power-saving mode is standby, and this is similar to that on most modern TV sets. You can leave the PC in standby mode for many days. In fact, this is now the preferred state of the computer when not in use. The standby and resume button, which is taking the place of the traditional power switch, is used to activate the computer, and when you've finished work, return it immediately to standby mode. Now note, You'll still need to shut down Windows in the usual way via the Start button and then Shutdown. Applications still running will need to be closed before Standby can be entered. If a complete shutdown is required, you can use the on-off switch on the rear of the system unit, or simply turn off the power at the main socket and remove the main lead. The monitor supplied with your system has similar power saving modes, and these include blanking the display after a set number of minutes, which is suspend, to a state of almost total power shutdown, which is standby. Pressing a key or moving the mouse will then reactivate the screen. Now note, after entering standby or suspend, the monitor power light will change from green to amber. If the screen has gone blank, make sure that the monitor has not entered any of these modes before suspecting a monitor fault. Power saving features can be controlled from either the computer BIOS, more of this later, or from Windows 95, and you can enable or disable power savings and specify the number of minutes before they activate. We recommend that you use the software settings, as more options are available. For activating and controlling the power management of the computer, run the power option in the Windows control panel. This allows you to set the hard disk drive, power downtime, and also to enable or disable the wake-up feature. Now for monitor power management, run the display option, which is also in the control panels, and this will show you the display properties window from where you can select the make and model of your monitor so that its available power saving capabilities are shown. You can then set these options by choosing Settings, and then Advanced Properties, and then Monitor. You can set the number of minutes before entering Standby and Suspend modes after choosing the Screensaver tab in Display Properties. Your PC system may be supplied with bundled software applications. Only some of the software may be pre-installed, the rest may have arrived on one or more CDs, and may need to be installed before it can be used. Now, if I don't mention a software application, it probably comes on CD. Bearing this in mind, the following is a list of applications that may be pre-installed on your Windows 95 PC. Lotus 12397 is a comprehensive spreadsheet. Lotus Word Pro 97 is a revolutionary new word processor. Lotus Approach 97, a very powerful database. Lotus Organizer, the electronic personal organizer. Lotus Freelance Graphics 97 Visual Presentation System. Lotus ScreenCam Multimedia Recorder. You can record mouse movements for any number of things, such as training. Quicken 5 for personal and small business financial management. Lotus Smart Center is a powerful tool that organizes your work and desktop clutter. GSP Pressworks Desktop Publisher with page pilots for instant designs. GSP DesignWorks Art and Graphics Suite, easy to use and has page pilots. GSP HomeWise, organize your house and keep track of household items. Most of your pre-installed software is accessible from the Start button in the bottom left-hand corner of the screen. For example, to load Lotus 123, a spreadsheet program, you would click on the Start button and then move the pointer to Programs. A submenu will appear. Move the pointer to Lotus Applications or Lotus Smart Suite 97, and finally click on Lotus 12397. In a few seconds, the Lotus 123 spreadsheet will be started. The rest of your pre-installed software can be started in the same way, and for more details on the pre-installed software, please refer to the pre-installed software guide. Lotus have engineered their applications so they contain similarities in use, such as printing and finding help. The applications have been specially written in this way so the user can use all the Lotus software with a minimum of training. Basically, if you learn how to use Lotus Word Pro, then Lotus 123 will be no problem. And in the same way, Lotus have provided a utility called Lotus Doc Online. And these are the actual Lotus application manuals, even in electronic media. However, if you need the printed manual, you can print out the electronic guides. With some software, you may receive a license agreement, and with others, you may not. But don't worry, the applications have either been pre-installed or are in one of our CDs. Now, under many agreements with the software publisher, your invoice is both proof of purchase and limited license to use the software. Now, I've very briefly gone over some of the preloaded applications, but for a more in-depth explanation, please refer to the pre-installed software guide. In a previous part of this video, I've talked about the backup CD and the Windows 95 CD. Now, the backup CDs can be purchased as optional extras, so they may not arrive with your PC. The backup CD contains the installable versions of your preloaded applications, so there's no need to create your install disks by using Diskmaster Pro. You can simply delete the Disk Pro folder using Windows Explorer by a right click, and deleting this will save you time and free up valuable disk space. But only delete the folder if you have the backup CD. Now, the Windows backup CD comes with a disk, and this disk is only to be used when you need to reload Windows 95 onto your PC. To use the Windows 95 CD, insert the floppy disk in the drive and the CD in the CD drive and switch on your PC. The PC will start up from the floppy drive and present you with a menu from which you select your CD-ROM drive. And then the Windows 95 CD takes over. Now, the aim of the CDs is to save you lots of disks and time when it comes to reloading Windows 95 or applications onto your PC. Installing Windows 95 off a CD-ROM could take about 30 minutes, and installing off floppy disks, well, let's just say it takes longer. Windows comes on 35 disks. Ouch. Now, a word about software compatibility. Many of the 32-bit applications and multimedia games will simply not run on computers that were selling 2 or 3 years ago. And likewise, this PC will run most current software, but it's not guaranteed to run all current or future software. The software licenses are for single-user use only on this system. You cannot copy this software and distribute it to anyone else. You may not loan, rent, lease, or license this software or any copy of it. The software is provided without any free training or support. Online help is available within most applications. Now, because software is inherently complex and may not be completely free from errors, you're advised to verify your work and to make up backup copies. It's well known for even popular applications, including Windows, to crash unexpectedly. For more information regarding copyright and compatibility, please refer to the software guide. When you have any Windows 95 problems, insert the recovery diskette in the floppy drive and restart your PC. The PC will automatically start loading off the floppy drive and load the recovery diskette menu. Now note, this is slower than starting up from the hard disk drive. The recovery diskette menu contains 9 options. The best and most effective way to use the recovery diskette is to start on option 1 and work your way through to option 5. The 9 options are these. Restore system files. This makes your PC bootable. Restore original Windows INI files. These are the Windows 95 information files. They're important for sound, printer, modems and programs. Restore original config.sys and auto.exec.bat. These are two of the main startup files, and this will fix most MS-DOS, mode sound or CD-ROM problems. Restore original registry information, the core of Windows 95 operating system and 32-bit compatibility. And number 5, this option will execute all of the above, and it performs the previous 4 options in 1 step. Number 6, Restore System, DAT, Device Manager. This is the part of Windows that holds information on the hardware in your PC. Restore Master Image, which will run the scan disk first, and this option will be explained later. Restore ARJ file to archive from floppy disk, that's also explained later. And number 9, go to a Windows 95 DOS prompt. That starts up the PC without entering Windows 95 and loading any other drivers. Now, after trying an option, you should check to see whether the problem has been fixed. Once the problem has been fixed, you shouldn't carry on trying any more options. Let's go over this procedure just one more time. Insert the recovery diskette in the floppy drive and switch on or restart the PC. Number 2, choose option from the list. First try option 1. Number 3, remove the diskette when prompted to do so and restart the PC. Number 4, check to see if the problem has been fixed. Number 5, if the problem has been fixed, then carry on using your PC as normal. Do not try any more options. Number 6, if the problem has not been fixed, then repeat number 1 and choose the next option from the menu. If you make software changes to your PC, it's recommended that you run the Make Recovery Diskette. This program is on the Windows 95 screen along with a help file. Double-click on the help file for more information on the recovery diskette. If your PC has a Windows 95 system problem, the first 5 options of the recovery diskette will fix it. If the problem is in one of your preloaded software applications, there's one more option on the recovery diskette you could try. And this is option 7, Restore Master Image. Let me explain what this option does. You imagine a copy of your software stored in one big file. This is a mirror copy of your hard disk's data and was made at the factory so that the data in this file is untouched. If you were to run option 7, the first screen you will see is a warning. And this is basically telling you that you must back up all your personal data before running the Restore Master Image program. What happens is the program will delete all the data and programs that were originally on the drive, including Windows 95, leaving only the Master Image Restore program and the file containing the copy of your hard disk. Now, the program then goes to work replacing the original files to their original places on the hard disk. It will replace the Windows files and programs like new, creating what we call a software reload. The image restore could take up to 50 minutes. It really depends on your PC specification. Now, once the image restore is complete, you'll be prompted to remove the recovery diskette and press any key. The PC will restart automatically. The image restore program has one final stage to perform. It will enter Windows 95 and automatically run a program that will restore all the Windows 95 long file names. After this, you need to shut down and restart, and there you have it. A brand new software reload without the PC having to be sent back to us. Now, I know that this option sounds a little drastic, and you might hesitate, but it's the most effective way to zap your software problems, and it can be used time and time again. In the unlikely event that part of the master image has been damaged, option 7 will give you a message telling you which part of the image file is corrupt. You should then contact our software assistance service, who can arrange to send you a disk containing an undamaged copy of that part of the image. Option 8 allows you to update your image file using this disk. The multimedia PC you've purchased will have a CD-ROM, sound card, speakers, and possibly a microphone and joystick. But what can you do with all this hardware? Well, the CD-ROM drive will be fitted, and it's at the front of the PC. There's a button to open and close the tray, and when you insert CDs into the CD-ROM drive, ensure that the printed surface is facing upwards and is placed in the centre of the tray. The most common way of CDs getting damaged is scratching. If the bottom, shiny surface of the CD gets scratched, there's a chance that the CD-ROM's laser will not be able to read the CD. Now, your sound card is at the centre of the multimedia system. It's also been fitted back at the factory, so all you have to do is use it. So how do you use a sound card? Well, software such as Windows 95, games, educational software, business software uses your sound card. In fact, any software that's been designed to have multimedia features. In Windows 95, multimedia software applications will use your sound card automatically. The only time you may have to tell your software to use the sound card is when playing games, particularly DOS-based games. The majority of games will have a setup screen where you choose from a list of sound cards, and it's important that you select the right one. Usually it's a Sound Blaster Pro or Sound Blaster compatible. Now, your joystick plugs into its own port on the rear of the PC, and it's only really used when you're playing games such as Doom. As standard, most game settings are for the keyboard, so you have to change the settings of games manually. Again, the setup program in the game will allow you to choose between keyboard and joystick control. Alternatively, you may need to run a separate setup program for the game. Now, to do this, open up a DOS session, change to the Doom folder by typing cd/doom, and once in the Doom folder, type setup, and this will bring up the setup program. Your multimedia PC will be provided with a pair of speakers. You may have standard passive speakers, which plug directly into the computer and require no external power. And when using such speakers, the controls on the speakers, such as the volume control, won't function. The volume is controlled via the sound card software or Windows 95. Or you may have active speakers, which require batteries or an AC mains adapter to power them. Now, in most cases, the adapter will be supplied with the speakers. And both these types connect in much the same way. One lead will join the two speakers together, whilst a second lead plugs into the line-out socket on the rear of the PC. If you have an internal modem fitted in your PC, you may notice that it may also have sockets for speakers and a microphone. Now, don't use these sockets, or you may not hear any sound. The more powerful speaker systems may come in the form of a subwoofer unit for enhanced bass response, and two satellite speakers. And with these, you connect the satellite speakers together into the subwoofer. Then connect this to the line-out socket. Your system may also have been provided with a microphone. Connect it to the mic socket, like this. Windows 95 has built-in multimedia support. It comes with a CD player, a media player, sound recorder, and volume control. Now, I'll quickly run through each one of these utilities. They're not difficult to use, and Windows 95 has endless help regarding these programs. You can use CD player to play audio compact discs from a CD-ROM drive connected to your computer. This means you can listen to your favorite music at the same time as you work on your spreadsheet. The media player can be used to play video clips, MIDI, and WAV sound files, and many other sound or visual files. The sound recorder, well, to use this program, you must have a microphone connected to the mic socket on the connector panel, or an external device plugged into the line-in socket. Simply record the desired sound using the record button, then play it back with the play button. Well, the volume control does exactly that. It controls the volume. Now then, you're wondering, this is all great, but how do I access these programs? Well, Windows 95 makes everything easy. You simply click on Start, and then Programs, Accessories, and finally Multimedia. And there they are. Simply click on the one you want. If you have problems with any of the Windows multimedia applications, the best thing for you to do is reinstall. And this may sound like a big job, but it's rather quick and easy to do. For this, you must enter the control panel, double-click on Add Remove Programs, click on Windows Setup, and here you have lots of Windows applications and utilities listed. And it's from here you have to remove and reinstall sections of Windows 95. Move down the list until you come to Multimedia. And next to it, there's a box with a tick in it. Remove the tick by clicking on the box with your left mouse button, and this, you're removing the multimedia applications of your PC. Click on OK, and then close. Restart your PC, and do exactly this time, highlight the multimedia sections and click on Details. Put a tick next to each one of the programs listed and click OK. Your PC will need to be restarted so the changes can take effect. Now, performing this simple operation of removing and then reinstalling applications fixes most software problems related to multimedia. A modem is a device which lets your computer talk to another computer down a telephone line. With the correct software, you can send faxes, you can surf the internet, and connect to information systems and bulletin boards, or BBSs. The modem is what makes the information superhighway possible. By giving you access to outside sources of information, the world is literally at your fingertips. The internet is short for the International Network. It's a global connection of millions of computers all linked to each other. And you use your modem to dial into one computer, and from there you can branch out and contact the others. You can download or transfer software from a remote computer to your own and access information on virtually any topic you can think of. You can also communicate with other users all over the world. Most PCs come fitted with an internal, ready-to-use modem, which you can see when you look at the rear of your PC. You attach one end of your modem cable to the connector marked line and the other end to your telephone socket. There's quite a bit of jargon attached to modems. Modems are described by the speed at which they operate. The faster the modem, the more data they can transfer in a given time. The standard modem is rated at 28,800 BPS, which is a measure of its data transfer rate. But the faster ones operate at 33,600 BPS or even 56,600 BPS. The faster your modem is, the less time you'll need to spend online, and the lower your phone bill will be, so you'll save money in the long term if you use the internet a lot. Now, some new modems also support voice facilities, and they include a socket to attach a video camera for video conferencing. Now, we'll cover setting up an internal modem because it has been known for customers to accidentally remove their internal modem settings. Before you start setting up your internal modem, you need to make sure that you have a communications port set up to which to connect. Internal modems are set to work on COM4 IRQ3. Your PC can have up to 4 communications ports, but normally you only have 2 set up unless you have an internal modem. And you can check what communication ports your PC has by clicking the Start button and select the Settings menu, then select Control Panel, and now double-click on the System icon. Click on the Device Manager tab, and then click on the Ports COM and LPT icon. If you have 4 COM ports, you can ignore what I'm going to say next. If you have 2 COM ports, click on the OK button. Now you can add COM 3 and 4 automatically by double-clicking the Maintenance folder on your desktop. When this opens, you'll see an option to add the extra ports. Simply double-click on this icon and COM3 and COM4 will be created for you. Now that we've all successfully set up our communications ports, and we've got 4 ports, you can set up your internal modem. Click the Start button and select the Settings menu, then select Control Panel. Now double-click on the modems icon. Now click on the Next button, and Windows 95 will try and detect your modem. Now it's recommended that you let Windows 95 detect your modem. If Windows 95 doesn't recognize your modem, this screen is displayed. Click on the Next button, and Windows 95 will give you a list of modems to select from. Select the modem you have, click on the Next button, or if you don't know the make and model of your modem, select standard 33600 modem. Either way, Windows 95 will ask you to select a communication port for your modem to use. Now, for internal modems, use COM4. Windows 95 then shows you this screen, telling you that you've successfully set up your modem. And click on the Finish button. Now Windows 95 shows you the modem properties screen. Click on the Diagnostics tab and then select COM4. Next, select on the More Info button, and this displays the following screen. This is information that Windows 95 has gained about your modem by communicating with it. This means that your internal modem is working and ready for use. But before we go on, a point to remember. If you have a problem with your modem, 50% of the time it's not your PC and modem that's at fault, but the modem at the other end of the line to which you're trying to connect. Remember, it takes two to tango. If there's a fax modem in your PC, you'll notice an application opens up every time you start Windows 95. And this is the Windows Inbox. In order for you to send or receive faxes, the Microsoft Inbox needs to be open. Back at the factory, most of the configuring for the inbox has been done for you. All you need to do is change the telephone number. To change the settings of the inbox, you must have it open and click on the taskbar to switch to the inbox, or if you have it closed, double-click on the icon located on the desktop. Click on Tools and move the pointer down to where it says Microsoft Fax, and a submenu will appear. Move into the submenu and click on Options. From here, the option box appears. Click on the tab across the top labelled User, and from here you can change your personal settings on the Microsoft Inbox. Sending a fax in Windows 95 is very easy. Firstly, you need the Inbox open, then move the pointer to Compose at the top and click. A pull-down menu will appear, and on the menu there are a few options, one of which is New Message and the other New Fax. The New Message option is for mail messages, and this is only ever used on a Windows 95 network. Click on the New Fax option, and after a few seconds, the Composer New Fax wizard appears. The first screen is as if you're using a portable computer, so you could tick this box, and the screen will not appear next time. Then click on Next, and here fill in relevant details. Now, once you've filled in all the blanks, click on Next. This screen asks you if you wish to send a cover page, and if you do, which one? Let's select Urgent, and then click Next. Fill in your fax message here, and once you've done so, click on Next. If you wish to attach a data file to your fax, select the file at this point by clicking on Add File, then click on Next. Now click on Finish, and your fax will be sent. If your modem has voice capabilities, you'll receive some software called SuperVoice. This basically allows your PC to act as a communication center for voice, fax, or data messages. In order to use it, you must have SuperVoice running in the background at all times so that it can receive incoming messages. You can also use SuperVoice to send voice messages using a telephone handset or a microphone attached to your PC, as long as the PC at the other end is also running SuperVoice actively. Now, SuperVoice can also be used to send faxes and data. As both SuperVoice and Microsoft Fax require control of the modem, you'll only be able to have one or the other running at any one time. Imagine a small network of computers talking to another network of computers, 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 and so on for a long time. That's what the internet is. It's a very, very, very big, huge massive network of computers. It sounds great, but how do you get on and become part of the internet? Well, we use an internet service provider, or an ISP, such as CompuServe, Pipex Dial, America Online. The list is endless. And basically, your internet provider gives you a service. For a monthly subscription, they let you have an internet address so people can send you email, and they can let you have data storage space on their file server so that you can create a web or a home page. And most importantly, they provide your PC with a point of entry to the internet. Now, with most internet providers, they supply a disk like CompuServe. You simply install the disks onto your Windows 95 PC, and when you install the CompuServe program, it'll ask you to fill out a registration form online. They'll hook you up immediately, and they usually give you a free trial period so you can test the internet and see if you like it before you pay anything. You may prefer to sign up with an ISP in your local area, and the subscription will be about the same, but many people prefer a local service as the technical help and support can be better. This is how it works. Let's say you live in London and you ring your ISP. Let's say it's Pipex Dial. So remember, it's a local call to the Pipex Dial file server. The Pipex Dial file server will then connect any address you give it. For example, I could log into the Pipex Dial file server and from there tell the file server that I want to look at Microsoft. The Pipex Dial server will log into the Microsoft server in America and then hook me up to that server. But remember, I'm only paying for a local call. This is what makes the internet what it is today. You can even email the President of the United States. It's just like sending a letter, only you get a quicker response. Now, once you're connected, the list of services and places you can access is endless. You can connect to hardware and software manufacturers' sites to download the latest drivers or program updates. You can access the research resources of companies, universities, and newspapers. Use the internet as a vast home shopping outlet. Contact user groups and discussion forums on every topic imaginable. Get instant up-to-date news, travel and weather information. Visit museums and art galleries online. Or just surf the net to see what you can find. The emergence of the internet and its impact on PC systems is best illustrated by the Internet Explorer 4 package, which is being shipped with most PCs. This is an amalgamation of the Windows Explorer, Windows 95's file management program, and the Internet Explorer 3 web browser. Other internet software is also incorporated, such as email, newsgroup readers, and even video conferencing software, giving a full suite of internet software tools. The Windows 95 desktop can be customized to resemble a web page. This allows you to give a much more user-friendly look to folders, with the addition of special fonts, backgrounds, links to websites, and graphical buttons to launch programs. You can even have active internet links on the desktop, such as continually updating weather maps or share prices. You can subscribe to your favorite web pages so that when the site is updated, you're notified and the changes can be sent to you automatically. Movement between web pages on the internet and files and folders on your PC is completely integrated using back and forward arrows on the browser. Because modem problems can be troublesome, we'll look at some common problems and their solutions. First, some general points about modems and phone lines. Try to avoid using an extension lead between your modem and the phone socket. The power carried by the phone line can be dissipated if the extension lead is too long. And don't have too many telephones operating on one line. If you have several other telephones and you're experiencing problems with the modem, try temporarily unplugging the other phones and see if this cures the fault. Problem: I can't send a fax using my modem. Solution: make sure Inbox is running and has been correctly set up and Microsoft Fax has been installed correctly. Now, to install Microsoft Fax, select Settings, Control Panel, Add Remove Programs, then select the Windows Setup tab. Now scroll down to the Microsoft Fax icon and place a tick in the box by clicking inside it once, and do the same with the Windows Messaging box. Then select Apply. Microsoft Fax will now be installed, and if the ticks are already present, it may be that you need to reinstall the fax software. To do this, click them again so that they're removed, then click on OK. Next, double-click on Add Remove Programs, then Windows Setup. Replace the ticks in Microsoft Fax and Windows Messaging, and then click on OK. The fax software will then be reinstalled. To set up Inbox, refer to Chapter 8 in your user guide. Problem: I can't receive a fax on my computer. solution. Make sure Inbox is running in the background, and if the problem persists, check to see if Inbox has been set up to receive a fax. In particular, check that the PC has been told to answer incoming calls after a set number of rings. Problem. When I dial a number using my communications program, there's no dial tone. Solution. It's possible that your modem cable has not been connected to your phone socket. Check that each end of the modem cable has been fully inserted into your modem and the phone socket. And also, try plugging the modem cable into a different phone socket in case there's a problem with that particular socket. Remember, if you have a problem with your modem, check to make sure that the modem at the other end of the line to which you're trying to connect is working. There's a fax back number which you can dial that has been set up to allow you to test your modem if you think it's not working. Please refer to the modem section in your user guide for more details and the number to call. Some systems may come fitted with an advanced PC TV system with teletext. Simply connect your TV aerial to the UHF connector and use the supplied software, which is normally preloaded. Now, please refer to the PC TV section in the user guide for details. The TV card can use the sound card speakers for audio output, and the teletext data can be dynamically linked to your spreadsheet. And remember, unlike the internet, this data is free, as there are no telephone charges. On some systems, the advanced 56kbps voice modem supports a digital video camera connection, and software is preloaded for full-feature video conferencing. Even without the digital video camera, such systems can receive video conferencing calls. And please refer to the video conferencing section in the user guide. If a digital camera is supplied, connect this to the camera socket on the modem. The software uses your sound card speakers and microphone for speech output and input. There are many digital cameras available for quality photography, which are usually sold as options. The camera will come with associated software and a cable to download the digital photographs to your PC. The cable connects to the COM port, and the software enables you to manipulate, store and print your snaps. Digital camera photography is destined to replace traditional film-based cameras. Now, if you want to print out documents or pictures, you'll need a printer. And there are three types of printer in common use: dot matrix, inkjet and laser. They all offer different levels of printing quality, with laser printers being the best. Once you've unpacked your printer, taking care to remove all sticky tape and foam paddings, you'll generally have the following: your printer, a printer cable if you bought one, a power cable, your printer's instruction manuals, and software drivers for your printer on floppy disk or maybe CD. Whatever type of printer you have, they all connect to your PC in much the same way. You connect your printer to your PC using the printer cable. Plug one end of the cable into the printer and the other into the port at the rear of your PC marked printer or LPT1. The two ends of the cable are different, so there's no danger of getting it the wrong way around. In order to use a printer, a software driver is needed. And this is usually supplied by the printer manufacturer on floppy disk or CD. If your printer is a very popular make, the printer driver will already be present in Windows 95. So let's see how we set up a printer in Windows 95. First, click on the Start button and from the Settings option, select Printers. Next, select the Add Printer icon and double-click. The Add Printer wizard will be activated, and then click on the Next button. And from the list of printers, select the make and model of your printer, and then click on the Next button. If your printer doesn't appear in the list provided, it's quite likely that your manufacturer has provided a printer driver disk CD specifically designed for Windows 95. So insert the driver disk in the floppy drive and click on the Have Disk button. Now follow the instructions which Windows provides for installing drivers from a floppy disk. And finally, if for some reason your printer drivers do not exist on the list provided by Windows 95 and your printer manufacturer hasn't supplied you with printer drivers for Windows 95, then you should contact your printer manufacturer. Some telephone numbers are provided of common printer manufacturers in Chapter 12 of your user guide. Once Windows has loaded drivers for your printer, you'll be prompted for the port from which to run your printer. Select LPT1 printer port and click on the Next button. Windows will now prompt you to enter the name of your printer. You have an option to enter a new name or keep the one provided by Windows. Select the Yes option to make your newly installed printer the default printer for all your Windows-based programs. Select the Yes option if you'd like Windows to print a test page and then click on the Finish button. And it's recommended that you select the Yes option as this will verify whether or not your printer has been set up correctly. Windows will now install your printer drivers and set up your printer. Windows will now print a test page if you answered yes when Windows prompted to print a test page earlier. And click on Yes if a test page has been printed. Now your printer should now appear in the Printers window. If a test page wasn't printed, then select the No button and Windows will try again. And if on the second attempt the test page hasn't been printed, then check that your printer is switched on and online. Also check that there's at least one sheet of paper in the printer. Now, if your printer doesn't respond even after meeting the above conditions, try installing the printer again. If it still doesn't print, then there may be a problem. Now, let's discuss these now. If your printer won't print, try the obvious solutions first. Make sure it's plugged in, switched on, and that the cable is firmly connected at both ends. Then try performing a printer self-test. To do this, refer to the printer's documentation supplied. Make sure the printer is online, that you haven't accidentally pressed the offline button. And make sure it has paper and that the paper's not jammed, because if some printers run out of paper, they have to be reset before they'll start printing again. Now in Windows, make sure that the correct printer is selected as the default printer. You'll find that Windows 95 contains a lot of information in the form of online documentation, and it's very important you use this information because it could save you a lot of time. Now, with that in mind, use the Windows Online Help to solve your printer problem. Simply click on Start, Help, Index tab, and type in Print Trouble. Click on Print Troubleshooting, and this will launch the Print Troubleshooter. This troubleshooter helps you identify and solve printer problems. Just click to answer the questions and then try the suggested steps to fix the problem. Finally, you may need to change the type of printer port you have set up, and we'll see how to do this later in the video. It's well worth getting to know the inside of your PC. Some problems may occur because a component has become dislodged inside your PC and it can be easily corrected without having to return your PC to us for repair. Please remember that not all hardware available today is compatible with your PC. We do offer a list of popular upgrade products that have been tested and also offer an in-house upgrade service which doesn't void your warranty. To look inside your PC, firstly you need to remove the cover. Whatever you design your PC is, desktop, mini tower or full tower, the cover is held by a number of fixing screws. But wait, before you attempt to remove the cover, ensure that the PC is turned off at the mains. To remove these screws, you'll need a Phillips screwdriver. It's complicated, doesn't it? In fact, it's not that bad. All PCs have similar components. The motherboard contains the main electronics of the computer, and it's the part to which all the main hardware items in the PC are attached. The central processing unit, or the CPU, is also known as the processor, and it's the brain of the computer, and all the computing work is handled by the CPU. The random access memory, or RAM, is used by the PC to store instructions and data temporarily while it's working. RAM is measured in megabytes, or MB, and it comes on single inline 72-pin memory modules, or SIMs for short, which are plugged onto the motherboard in pairs, or dual inline 168-pin memory modules, DIMMs for short, which can be plugged in singly. The hard disk drive is where the PC permanently stores all of its software and data. The capacity of the hard disk is measured in megabytes, or MB, or gigabytes, which is thousands of megabytes. The 3.5-inch floppy disk drive lets you exchange data and software between your PC and your floppy disks. The CD-ROM drive is an additional storage device. It allows software to be installed and used faster than from conventional floppy disks. The power supply converts the main supply into voltage that powers the motherboard and other hardware components in the PC. The expansion slots are used to plug in additional cards, such as modems, network adapters, and sound cards. The graphics card may be on an expansion card or may be integrated into the motherboard. The sound card is usually integrated too, but it may be on a separate card. As I mentioned earlier, the CPU, or processor, is the brains of your PC. And recent processor technology has advanced immensely, and this has seen new types of processors being launched on the market. Now, inevitably, there's been some confusion about processors and distinguishing between them. And in this section, we'll briefly describe the types of processors that may be fitted in your PC. Your PC is fitted with one of the following processors. The 686 processor incorporates features which allow twice the number of instructions to be executed at the same time and keep information flowing faster. So this gives the 686 superior performance and processing power for current and future applications. And the 686 is known by its PR rating. The PR rating is a measure of the level of performance that a processor delivers. The need for a PR rating arises from the fact that different processors deliver different levels of performance at the same clock rate, or megahertz. Now, the PR rating of any non-Intel processor is its performance comparative to its Intel Pentium equivalent. For example, an IBM 686 P200 at 150 MHz means that the IBM Cyrix 686 runs at 150 MHz, but its performance is equivalent to, and in fact it's slightly higher than, the Intel Pentium 200. Pentium class processors are also available with MMX technology, multimedia extensions. Intel Pentium processors were the first to be launched with speeds of 166, 200 and 233 MHz. MMX technology is designed to accelerate multimedia and communication software. These processors contain extra instructions and a larger internal cache, allowing them to reach new levels of performance. Software that works on a non-MMX processor will also work on the MMX version of that processor. However, to get the benefits of MMX technology, you need software written specifically to make use of the MMX features. And this software usually carries the MMX logo. The Pentium 2 is mounted on its own daughter card, a separate circuit board which plugs into a slot on the main motherboard, in much the same way as a conventional expansion card. Now, this is known as slot 1, and it'll be the basis for future Intel processor development. The daughter card also contains the secondary cache memory and employs a large heatsink instead of the conventional CPU fan. The Pentium 2 has a 32 kilobyte internal cache, MMX instruction sets, and it uses segment register caches to improve the performance of 16 and 1632-bit applications, allowing it to run older Windows software more efficiently. It's available at speeds of 233, 266, and 300 MHz. IBM Cyrix's answer to the Pentium 2 uses the standard Socket 7 motherboard and has a 64K internal cache with MMX extensions. This processor also has the ability to reduce the power consumption of the PC by controlling the flow of power to peripherals. It employs the PR rating system of the 686 series, with the PR200MX running at 150 MHz clock and 70 MHz bus speeds. IBM Cyrix claims similar performance to a Pentium 2 at much lower costs. The BIOS, or Basic Input-Output System setup program, is stored on the computer's motherboard in a ROM BIOS chip. The BIOS setup is a program that controls and configures your PC's hardware. It's a permanent record of the system configuration, and it's always there even when your PC's turned off. Now, PCs may come equipped with a BIOS from one of several software companies depending on the system you've purchased. The information about what BIOS your computer has appears on the screen when you turn on the computer, and it's also detailed in the motherboard manual which is supplied with your system. You may access the BIOS program when your PC is booting up. A message is displayed on the screen for a short while, and then it disappears. Depending on the type of BIOS you have, this message and method of access into the BIOS program will vary. During boot up, the BIOS checks the record created with the setup program. If it discovers a problem with your system's hardware, a message will appear on the screen asking you to enter the setup program and correct the information there. Now, many setup options are highly technical in nature and should be changed only by knowledgeable users or service professionals. Do not reset any setup values on your PC unless you understand the consequences of the changes. The BIOS setup program is usually run when setting the date and time on your PC. You may have heard of the so-called Millennium Bug, where older computers will be unable to recognize dates after 2000 AD. Well, rest assured that all of our computer systems are Millennium compliant, and their internal clocks will be unaffected by this problem. Setting security controls, such as passwords, and remember, write it down and keep it safe. Setting power conservation features. Setting the type of parallel port you have, e.g. SPP or ECP or EPP, called the onboard parallel mode. This is sometimes necessary if your printer won't print anything, or it won't print all of a document. If you've been through the other printer troubleshooting points, try each setting in turn to see if it cures the fault. Increasing video memory up to 4 meg. This only applies, of course, if you have an integrated graphics motherboard and at least 16 meg of RAM. In the unlikely event that you lose your BIOS settings, in other words, the BIOS program forgets what configuration your BIOS was set to, then you can recover your settings by accessing your BIOS program and loading the default values. Next, auto-detect your hard drive. On Pentium 2 systems, this is done automatically. Finally, save and exit the BIOS program. This then restarts your PC with its original configuration. Routine maintenance of your PC is important, and it helps your PC to keep running smoothly. Now, this mainly involves tidying up your hard drive and taking precautions to avoid viruses infecting your PC. You should routinely use Windows 95 defragmenter to defragment your hard drive. This basically takes the data on your hard drive and puts it in one big chunk instead of it being scattered all over the hard drive. To use the defragmenter, click on Start and then select the Programs menu. Next, select the Accessories menu, and then select the System Tools menu. Then click on Disk Defragmenter. The Disk Defragmenter then asks you to select which drive you want. Next, click the Start button, and when the Disk Defragmenter has finished, click Yes to exit. Also in the Accessories folder is a program called ScanDisk, and this is a piece of software which checks your hard drive for errors and makes sure that it's running efficiently. ScanDisk can automatically fix most of the errors that it comes across. In the Windows 95 desktop, there's a recycle bin. If you delete anything, it's put in here, and therefore you must empty it regularly. Now, a virus is a small piece of code, a program which attaches itself to a file on your hard disk, and when this file is run, the virus runs too. It may try to copy itself to other programs, and it may perform any number of insidious acts. Typical virus symptoms include strange messages appearing on your monitor, or strange graphics such as a bouncing ball, or strange noises coming from your PC's speaker. Files you know should be on your disk are missing, or your PC becomes very slow and programs which normally run perfectly suddenly crash. The more deadly viruses can destroy software or system information. Fortunately, there are precautions you can take to protect your computer against viruses. Computer viruses don't float around in the air. Your PC can only catch a virus from an infected program, which means if you never ever load a piece of software onto your computer and never take software from strangers, your computer will be safe. That's hardly practical. However, you can guard against viruses by running an antivirus program, and there are several on the market. Also, never load anything onto your PC before you've checked it for viruses.
We hope you found this video useful, and there are other video products available. For example, there's one which covers Windows 95 in more detail, and that should be available from your sales contact. If you've got any suggestions on how this video could be improved, or any other feedback on products and services, please fill in and return the postage paid customer registration card. Time Computers values your comments and will try to incorporate your suggestions into products and services.